YouTube.com/TimWestwoodTV.
What's up, man? It's Immortal Technique, Westwood TV. You know what it is, baby. Just want to talk with my brothers over here. You got albums coming out, and just talk a little bit about what the process was for you. I know this is your second record, CF Ascension, coming out. How much time did you spend in the studio really refining bars and going over things, do you think?
Within the bars, like me and Southpaw, the creative process was us working together. And we was, we sat down together like roughly 2-3 hours. We would have multiple freestyle sessions until something would come out. Shit, even on this project, I traveled all the way to Rome to get inspired to write a song on my on this record, Ascension, named Young Lord, which is, you know, a phenomenal joint about a messianic figure that I definitely, you know, hope people will.
Speaking of travel, you do travel a lot, actually. Even without myself, you go a lot to Scandinavia, France, Italy. How do people hear about you? Is it online? Is it because you do songs with other artists? What do you think is what makes you the most popular on your own?
I think a lot of people know me because of the fact that I always, you know, I'm always looking for data in order for me to write. Each travel that I do, every place I go to, there's research and development. The culture, it gives me stimulus to want to write stuff. I'm like Johnny Five from Short Circuit. But the people mainly know me because of my freestyle and my writings, and now, of course, like the song development that is reaching, now its apex, like with Viper.
My brother over here, Hasan Salaam, the new record is called Life in Black and White. What does that title mean to you? Because I know you've done other albums before, and the titles were significant to what your struggle was, or what we were going through, or what was around you in Jersey at that time. Camden and Newark, Jersey City. What was the process of coming up with the title, and what does that mean to you?
Well, for me, all of my albums have followed Allah's mathematics, knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And this joint right here is the third part of my releases. So this one is the understanding. Paradise Lost was the knowledge. Children of God was the wisdom and the experience. And this is the understanding of what my life has been like. So it's extremely personal, because every song on this is dealing with a particular aspect of my life. You know, I call it Life in Black and White because growing up, people used to call me a jungle boy because the album, the movie Jungle Fever was out. So, you know, my father is Italian and German ancestry, and my mother is African American. But a lot of times I want people to understand, I used to do photography, and the things in black and white pictures that made them so interesting is the gray area. You know, and this album is the gray area in life. You can't just say everything is black, everything is white, everything is right, everything is wrong. Because when you hungry, you know what I'm saying, some of the things that people might consider to be wrong all of a sudden fall into a gray area of, I'm gonna eat tonight. I don't give a fuck if you think if it's right or wrong. You know, and that's what the joint is dealing with.
You mentioned a personal struggle in the music. What was the biggest sacrifice that you had to make in order for your musical career to really go where it's at right now, to the point where you're touring internationally, you have a record that's coming out globally, you know, you have a major independent distribution, and you finally are living off of the music that you make and stuff. What is the largest sacrifice that you would say that you had to put out there?
Man, a lot of people might say sleep. You know what I'm saying? But I'm an insomniac anyway, so I don't really need that. I think it's time. You know, I'm away from my family a lot. And then also, time is just dedicated to making music. You know, cats be like, yo, let's go hang out, let's chill. Nah, I'm going to the studio. Nah, I gotta write a song. Nah, I'm very similar to CF. If I'm gonna talk about a particular subject that's outside of my experience, I'm gonna do research. So I'm gonna read, I'm gonna study. You know, and it's just like, for me, it's the same as training physically. You know, if I'm training for a fight, if I'm training somebody for a fight, you know, you're not gonna go out there and party. You're not gonna go out there and put the wrong foods and substances in your body. You're gonna make sure that everything up here is right.
So speaking of training, people don't know this about you, but you're very, very into fitness and you're very into being healthy. You have a complete regimen. Talk a little bit about those the gyms and all the stuff that you've been working on with that.
Recently, I'm a co-owner of a fitness studio in Clearwater, Florida, called Body Altitudes. My partners, Jesson and Jasmine and Pamela Socorro, have extensive fitness backgrounds and everything from Bikram yoga to weight training, Zumba, and I bring the street training aspect and boxing aspect to it. And everything that I've done, I got a thank my brother right here, because he was always like, yo, get off them bogeys. Your breath control is going to be even better. And I got into a situation where, you know, I've been training at boxing since I was a shorty. And I had stopped training for a while. And I was in a bar, and this dude come at me. And it's like riding a bike, you know what I'm saying? So after that, one of my boys was like, I know you knew you was nice with your hands like that. I want you to teach me how to do that. And it actually got me into training again, to train other people and work with young people to teach them how to defend themselves and things like that. So I feel like it's the same thing as what you do mentally with writing rhymes. You train your body.
Speaking of lifting weights, you can bench press about 400 pounds. People don't know that about you. But, you know, talk to me about how you feel your physical conditioning and the power that you have physically is in contrast to what you do mentally. Are those two things aligned? Like, do you feel like if you don't work out or if you're not in the gym that you take away from your ability to rhyme? Or how do you feel that health and mental health and physical health go hand in hand in your experience?
Well, first off, like, I gotta thank you for like the revolutionary message that you and you befriended me many years ago. It influenced me to take a turn for trying to internalize that and then going into the weights and making that. Because I feel like the two are married, you know what I mean? If you say something and you speak to people about change or whatnot, you're reaching out, you know, to humanity. You also want to be a presentation. You know, you're out there like on product display to be like, I am what I live. You know what I mean? So that I think the two together is what made me a better artist, right? Is what made me have better bars. Because when I go in the gym and I finish a set, then it makes me feel like, wait a second, if I did that, then I could go out there and beast out and make a killer song, you know? Right. So that and going out to seeing the world in combination with lifting weights, and with your stuff as well, and Viper, it all brings me up to that level, ascension.
Now, obviously, you're a monster on the microphone, but when you get off the microphone and you have a conversation, people get to know you and they know that you're very intelligent and you can speak intelligibly on all the subject matter that you discuss. What do you think people are most taken aback by? What do you surprise them most by? What do you see that they're like, because I've definitely met people that they see you on stage and they're like kind of scared of you, and then they'll come talk to you after the show and you'll be down to earth, you freestyle with people, you know, you do the same thing we do, you in the crowd. What's the biggest misconception about constant flow?
Well, a lot of people, when I get on stage, I go into a different kind of universe, you know what I mean? I'm in a different type of dimension. It's something, to me, it's something godly. I think rhyming is like, you know, what the great prophets used to meditate, and God would come down and feed them information like a lotus flower, like a satellite or something of that nature. And I take the energy from the crowd and I feed it back to the people or whatnot. And that when I step off stage, that goes off and I become just, you know, a regular person or whatnot. So that's the interesting thing about my personality, is that it can switch from on and off, you know. Not that I'm crazy, but just that when I get on the stage is a arena. The stage is a place of, I am a combatant, I am a gladiator, I'm going out there to, you know, to this is kind of a war-like thing. But off stage, I'm just a regular person like everybody else, you know?
You grew up in New Jersey, in Camden, and then
Camden, Jersey City, and Teaneck,
sorry. Talk to me about how growing up in Jersey affected your rhymes and your style. Because a lot of people know New York as being a place that's a big metropolis and then it's grimy. And then they don't understand what goes on across the river. Like, I know because I'm a New York nigga, and I know that you can't fuck around in Newark, you can't really play games in certain parts of Jersey City. Just like some people come out here to London and they think it's sweet until they get beat the fuck up and get their chain yapped, you know, because everywhere in the world got drama. But tell me, what was it about Jersey you think that growing up in that area really influenced your music to be what it is?
Well, I think the three places that I grew up in Jersey all had a specific and unique influence on me. Like, when I was a kid, Camden, and probably still is the murder capital of the United States. You know, my grandmother, she was a teacher and very active in the community in Camden, and we was always in the church, but, like, you know, it was kind of like on the block, in church. And then my grandmother was kind of like a block mother. Like anybody on the block needed something, they come to my grandmother. And she was just hard. Like she was very Camden, New Jersey, you know what I'm saying? But it's like you can't play around out there. You know, like the house right next door where my best friend used to live at, it was a brothel. You know what I'm saying? And his moms ran the brothel. And then right up the block of the other family that we knew, that it was, they was hustling all day. So it was like my grandmother was very much focused on trying to get me educated. Like, you know, you got to rise above. You got to do other things with your life. Not saying that you better than nobody, but you got to do something different with your life. You know, and then my mother, she moved up to North Jersey, you know, between Jersey City where my father lived. My father is like in the Italian and Irish and all the kind of people in Jersey City. And Jersey City is in the shadow of New York. And I grew up on Pamirpo, which is right there by Curry Woods Project. So it was like wild running around growing up and doing crazy things and whatnot. And then my mother decided like she wanted out of the city and moved to Teaneck, which is a suburb, but it's a suburb that is primarily in one section that was racially steered. It's all black and Latino in this one section. And it's very racially divided there. So at the same time, you know, where people are striving to do better, there's still somebody is trying to keep you back. So I think between those three places, it just made me view the world. Because I remember as a kid in Teaneck, a young man by the name of Philip Pinnell was shot in the back by the police. And it was just something that made me realize, like, yo, no matter where you go, there's something, whether it's poverty, your color, the language you speak, gender, whatever it is, there's always something that somebody above you is going to try to use against you to keep you down. And that's really what I'm speaking about on the album here, is just trying to show that all this black and white they try to separate us with, it's the gray area that brings us together and makes us one common thing, you know?
It's very powerful. I'm not going to ask you what your favorite song is to wrap it up, but if you could let a person hear a song first from Ascension, what would be the first song you would want them to hear when they heard the record?
Given the light of what's going on in Palestine, what's happening in Gaza, and specifically, I would advise them to listen to the song Moment of Peace. Because the ideas that we took actually biblical, monotheistic biblical figures, you know, the Jesus of today, which would be, you know, your next door neighbor from Mexico for Americans, you know, borders, immigrants. The Muhammads of today is like a poor kid that's probably living in Gaza trying to get some education. And because of his circumstances, he has no other sort of group to look forward to but like a Hamas or someone in Lebanon, like Hezbollah or something of that nature. And then, like, you know, with like with the Moses figure of today, you know, it would be like we unfortunately shed light, like if there was a Mossad agent and he was living in that circumstances where he's just trying to survive, giving the light of what happened during the Holocaust and all that within another area, all the complexities involved in those personalities living in today, you know, and of course Immortal Technique is featured on that song.
That's what's up. So just to close it up, obviously we're all very proud of the record Ascension, and definitely very proud of the record Life is Black in Black and White. We're not going to ask you what the favorite song is. We're going to ask you which one you want the audience to hear first.
I'd rather you hate me for who I am than love me for who I ain't. And I've been up in too much sin to claim to be no saint. Only God can judge me. That song right there, I think, sets it off because it talks about my life. And, you know, people make all these misconceptions, but it's just like, yo, I'm going to be who I am. I don't give a fuck what you think. So it's either you riding with me or you're going to get run the fuck over, you know?
Well, that's what's up, man. Immortal Technique, Hasan Salaam.
Sure.
Constant Flow, CF. Peace. Westwood, we out of here, baby. One.
YouTube.com/TimWestwoodTV.